Okay, welcome everyone to the DDPS seminar. Before we introduce our invited speaker, let's go over some rules and logistics. First of all, please mute yourself during the talk. But if you have questions, you can unmute and ask questions during the talk, or you can leave your questions in the chat room so that we can address them in Q&A session at the end. Second, today's DDPS seminar is open to external audience. Therefore, no classified discussion is allowed, so please watch out. Finally, the talk today will be recorded and uploaded in our YouTube channel. All right, let me introduce our speaker today. It is an honor to host Dr. Akhil Nekanti, who is a postdoctoral scholar in the Division of Engineering and Applied Sciences at Caltech. He received his PhD from the University of California, San Diego, in 2023. His research interests include reduced order modeling, hydrodynamic stability, aeroacoustics, and turbulent flows. He specializes in high fidelity numerical simulations and developing data-driven techniques for flow control and the discovery of flow physics. Today, Akhil will talk about data-driven techniques for analysis of turbulent flows. I'm sure we are going to hear a wonderful talk from him. Before I pass the baton to Akhil, as a tradition to the DDPS seminar, let me ask a somewhat informal questions to him just to get to know him better. And today's questions to you, Akhil, is I happens to know that you like to listen to the audiobook and you likes the nonfictions, and if you recommend any one nonfiction book to everyone, mm-hmm. and why, if you can share that with us, that would be awesome.
Yeah, so recently I've been listening to this audiobook called Chaos, The Making of a New Science by James Gleick. Yeah, I kind of like it. It's like different stories of different scientists from various fields and how they encountered chaos and so on. So I find it like really interesting and inspiring. So I'd probably recommend that.
Is it easy to read?
Yeah, it's easy to read.
Oh, cool. Okay.
It's nice. More like stories. You don't have any technical stuff. Yeah.
Okay. I might listen to that as well. Thank you for recommendation. Okay, the floor is yours, Akhil.
Yeah. Thanks for the introduction. So today I'm going to talk about the recent advancements that we have made in data-driven techniques for analysis of turbulent flows. Yeah, so turbulent flows are chaotic in nature, and as a result of which, they're very hard to predict. Additionally, they exhibit a wide range of scales, going from large scales to small scales. And it is these to get a complete picture of these turbulent flows, we have to refine all these, even these very small scales, which requires a fine mesh. And this makes them computationally challenging to simulate. However, even within this highly chaotic nature, there exists some orderly patterns of motion, which we term them as coherent structures. And these coherent structures are dynamically and also energetically important in these turbulent flows. As an example, here are the experiments of a mixing layer by Brown and Roshko. As we can see here, these are this at the top panel is the lower Reynolds number, at the bottom panel is a higher Reynolds number, where we can see that even on increasing the higher Reynolds number, the large scale structure more or less doesn't change, but the small scale structure significantly changes. So this gives us an understanding of why it is important to understand these large scale structures, so that it can be easy to understand and model turbulent flows. And here are two additional examples of the wake of a flat plate and a Gulf stream, where we see that here as well, we see the presence of a large scale structure that is representative of a Von Karman water street. And these coherent structures are actually present in all kind of turbulent flows and even in oceanographic flows. As an example of here is the presence of these large mesoscales, which are responsible for the circulatory motion of these ocean. So the one application which I'm more interested about is which I focused in my research is on the generation of jet noise. So Here is an example of a military jet during takeoff. And as the flow comes out from the nozzle exit, it interacts with the surrounding ambient fluid and forms these coherent structures, which are the sources of jet noise. And this is a numerical rendition of this, where here we can see that these coherent structures emit radiations in the downstream direction and in the sideline direction. And especially the downstream propagating waves are significantly loud and can result about to hearing loss for the people working in the near field, and also to the people living nearby the airports during takeoff and landing. And here is a neat example taken from the work of Nichols and Lele, where we can see the coherent structure being emitted from these radiation being emitted from this coherent structure. So the goal here is to first characterize these coherent structures and then develop techniques so that we can control the emission of noise. So this is where these data-driven techniques come into picture. So given a turbulent flow field, they help us in extracting these coherent structures. And by extracting these coherent structures, they provide us a low-dimensional representation of the system. And once we have a low-dimensional representation of the system, we can then develop reduced order modeling of these flows and then further perform flow control. And here is an example of the flow control performed by Mora et al., where they have used eigensystem realization algorithm to perform to delay the bypass transition in boundary layers. So by using these kind of techniques, one can not only reduce the computational complexity, but can also manipulate them for various different uses. So what kind of data-driven techniques to use? There exists a wide range of data-driven techniques existing from proper orthogonal decomposition, dynamic mode decomposition, and various other techniques as well. In this talk, I will focus on spectral proper orthogonal decomposition, and recently it has emerged as a popular tool for analyzing turbulent flows. The original work and traces back to the work of Lumley in late 1960s and early 70s, where he laid out the mathematical framework for it. Essentially, in one sentence, it is the frequency domain version of the principal component analysis. And its major advantage is that it extracts modes that are coherent in both space as well as in time. So what we do in SPOD is we first compute the cross spectral density matrix and then solve this eigenvalue problem to obtain the modes and the eigenvalue. The reason why it has become a powerful tool for analyzing turbulent flows is because of its equivalence with other methods, as shown recently by Towney et al., where they show that SPOD has the counterpart with respect to the resolvent analysis, which is an operator-driven method. And they have shown that the SPOD modes are nothing but the spatially uncorrelated white noise forcing resolvent response modes. And similarly, they have also shown that SPOD modes are optimally average DMD modes. So overall, considering the advantage of this and its equivalence with other methods, we will use this for various different extensions. So this brings me to the outline of my talk. So I've divided it into three different parts. And in the first part of this talk, I will show how we extend this for estimating missing data in a flow field. And in the second part, I will go over how we use this for identifying the intermittency of coherent structures. Excuse me. And in the third part, we will extend this to higher order statistics, to the third order statistics, to identify the triadic interactions. So first, why it is important to estimate the missing data? So many experimental measurements contain gaps or artifacts. For example, in particle, here is an example of particle emergency velocimetry of gas turbine combustor, where you can see the presence of these gaps. These gaps can occur due to various reasons. Probably they are due to reflection from the surface or the lack of seeding particles. And similarly, even in satellite measurements as well, the presence of the cloud cover can block these measurements, and as a result, we might get these gaps in the sea surface temperatures. So it is essential to get a complete flow picture to first analyze these flows. And in order to get a complete data set, researchers have used different techniques, which includes interpolation, Kriging, and gappy POD. So Kriging can be both spatial and spatial and temporal interpolation. And so the gappy POD was originally proposed by Everson and Sirovich, and later extended by Venturi Karnatakis, and further there have been significantly more extensions of this for different applications as well. So as opposed to this, what we do in this work is we propose a method that leverages both the spatial and temporal coherence for reconstructing this missing data. And on doing so, this method has various different applications. For example, they can be used in nonlinear model reduction, and also, for example, in the optimal placements of sensoring. And here is the example of Yang et al., where they have selected optimal placements of sensors for ocean measurements. And in this work, they have used gappy POD. So to demonstrate our method, we use the experimental data set that was acquired by Zhang et al. And Ukulele, where they have performed experiments of a turbulent cavity flow at a high Reynolds number of 3.3 × 10⁻⁵ and a Mach number of 0.6. And this data set contains total about 16,000 snapshots. So before I go into the algorithm of the method, this is just a quick sneak peek showing that even in the case where we remove 20% of missing data and where these data have been, these missing regions have been randomly seeded and sized, we observe that our algorithm is able to perform well and reconstructs the missing region, and it's comparable to that of the original data. So to first start off, I will first give an overview of SPOD and then our gappy-based POD. SPOD first starts off by taking all the snapshot ensembles, and then once we have the snapshot on ensembles, we then divide them into overlapping blocks, and where each block is considered as a statistically independent realization according to the ergodic hypothesis, and then we perform Fourier transform on each block. So once we do this, we obtain different frequencies in each blocks, as seen by the different colors here. Then we choose the same frequency from each block and arrange them into a new matrix. This is the matrix of Fourier realizations. So once we have this matrix of Fourier realization, we can then compute the cross-spectral density matrix, which is given by this, and then solve this eigenvalue problem to obtain the SPOD modes and eigenvalues, that is lambda. So to give a quick example of performing SPOD on the turbulent cavity flow, this is the cavity flow, and if we perform SPOD on this, we get two main outputs. One is the eigenvalue spectrum and two is the modes. So the eigenvalue spectrum shows us that how the energy is distributed across different frequencies, and at one frequency how it is distributed across different eigenvectors. So this spectrum is the first SPOD mode, or the leading SPOD mode, and contains the most energy and is sorted in the decreasing order of its energy preference. And here I'm showing four different modes of a low frequency to higher frequencies, and two of which corresponds to the different Rossetti-Herz frequencies. So using this, we can first identify the SPOD modes, which represents the different coherent structures. And now we will use these coherent structures to reconstruct back the original flow field. So to reconstruct back the original flow field, it requires an inverse SPOD process. So in this, what is required is first, we can think of this as the data being decomposed as a linear combination of these different SPOD modes. And so for this, we have to first obtain the expansion coefficient for each of these modes, which can be directly obtained from the SPOD by a rescaling of these of the chronos, or psi given here. Once we have the expansion coefficients, we can then obtain back the Fourier realization by a multiplication of the modes with that of the expansion coefficient, and take the inverse Fourier transform to obtain back the blocks, and finally get back the data. Notice that we might have to consider into effect of overlap between blocks, so we can do a weighted average to get this back. So now, since we are able to reconstruct the data from that of the modes, I will show how we have extended this for reconstructing of missing data. So consider a case where there is some missing data or has compromised region. So in this case, if we would form SPOD on the entire data set, that would result in modes which are corrupted or have these missing regions. So what we do is to circumvent this, we first divide them into each blocks and then remove the blocks that contain these missing regions while performing SPOD, and then perform SPOD on the remaining blocks. So once we do this, we have all the expansion coefficients for the remaining blocks, but not for the block that has this missing region. So to obtain this, what we do is we project these blocks onto the good modes, that is the modes that have been computed excluding these compromised regions. By doing this, we can get the expansion coefficients of these missing block, for example. And once we get the expansion coefficient, again we form a same process as previously, where we compute the Fourier realization and then take the inverse Fourier transform to get back the blocks, and then use this to fill in the snapshot. Note that we do this for one gap, and then we do this iteratively so that all the missing region in one particular gap has been converged. And by converged, I mean the solution that is being predicted by our algorithm does not change even as the iteration number changes. So once it reaches that point, we assume it has reached convergence. So this is, and we do this for one gap at a time, and then once we finish one gap, we move on to the next gap and do this iteratively for all gaps. And this is what we term as the outer loop. That is, filling all the gaps once is considered as outer loop, and then we again repeat this process entirely over all gaps multiple times such that the entire solution does not change. And so this is what we term as the global loop for this algorithm. So now to look at some results. So here is the result of the case of a 5% of missing data shown by here, where these gaps also have been chosen randomly. So what I'm plotting here is on the y-axis the global relative error, on the x-axis is the iteration number. And as you can see, the global relative error starts from 1, and as each of the gaps starts getting filled, it decreases and finally converges to a certain value. Of here, it's about 0.2. Note that here in this, the distance or the iteration numbers between these two gray dashed lines represents the inner loop, that is each gap being filled up till convergence. So this is also shown here, where this relative error represents the relative error for each individual gap. And for convergence, here we have used a tolerance of 10 to the power minus 8 as a L2 norm. And if once the L2 norm reaches 10 power minus 8, then we assume that has converged for this particular gap. And so this here I'm showing three different gaps. And so this is the inner loop here, and the outer loop represents the filling of all the gaps once, that is filling of this, and so on up till end. And that is given by this extent and up to the blue solid line over here. And finally, global loop is the total number of iteration it takes for the final value to converge. So here is an example of the 5% case. Now we also considered three different cases of 1%, 5%, and 20%, and we observe that in all cases, our algorithm is able to reconstruct the data and also reaches about 20% in a relative error of 20% in each case. Note that the only difference for the significant difference here is as you have higher number of data, you require a higher number of missing data, you require a more number of iterations to finally converge to the minimum value. So now I've shown the quantitative estimates. Now here for a qualitative representation, here I'm showing three different snapshots, and where the first snapshot represents the individual error which has maximum instantaneous error. As you can see here, a large part of the flow field over here is missing, and but even in such a case, our method, as it leverages both the spatial and temporal coherence, it is able to reconstruct the flow field and is comparable to that of the original data over here. And this is also observed for two other time instances, which have been randomly chosen. And here as well, we observe that our algorithm is able to estimate the data in these regions. Now we compare our method to two standard methods such as Kriging and gappy-POD. So here I considered all three different cases and also another data set of a cylinder flow at a low Reynolds number. So overall, in all these cases, what we observe is our method, the gappy SPOD, outperforms both Kriging and gappy POD. So here, the relative error is shown on the y-axis, and the mode number is shown on the x-axis. So note that this mode number arises due to the gappy POD, where they have a free parameter. So in gappy POD, what is done is they perform the analysis for different mode numbers and finally choose the mode which gives them the least error. Not mode number, but the number of modes. So overall here, what we observe is in all cases, gappy POD is significant, shows a significant lower error than both of that of gappy POD and that of Kriging.
I have a question. So SPOD, gappy SPOD does not depend on the number of modes?
No, yeah. So what we do is we use the entire number of modes. We use all the modes, yes. So it does not depend. I mean, it can technically also depend by using a certain number of modes, but we find, yeah, you can also do that if there are some computational limitations to that, but it does not depend on that. And what we observe is if we use all the modes, is that is when we get the least number of result, least error. So that's why it does not depend on mode number.
Yeah, well, the computational cost of the gappy SPOD would be higher than gappy POD then?
Was
you're using all?
I mean, in terms of memory, yes. In terms of memory, yes. But in terms of computational time, probably not. Because here for gappy POD, you have to converge it for each mode and then move on to the next mode and then converge it for that and so on, so on. And then you have to repeat this process entire process for filling in all the data for multiple, for all different modes number, right? Like let's say the data set has 10,000 snapshots, then you have 10,000 different modes. So it requires doing all that. So computationally, in terms of time, it would probably be gappy POD is higher in some cases. In some cases, it's not. It's overall similar. I mean, we have shown this in our paper, but we find that overall it's comparable. In terms of memory, yes, the SPOD is probably higher.
Okay, looks like Palani has a question. He raised his hand.
Yes, hi, thanks. Hi, Akhil, this is Palani here from India.
Mm-hmm.
I have a question on the previous slide where you showed the global relative error coming down to 20% for all three different sets, missing data of 1% or 5 or 20%. Is there any significance to why the global relative error comes down to 20% for all the cases, irrespective of the amount of missing data?
I actually think it's like, it's a coincidence, and there is no guaranteed measure. It's just a coincidence. Yeah. There is no significance, as you can. So that is only what we observed in the presence of this cavity, for this cavity flow. Whereas if you look actually at the cylinder flow, the error is, you can see that for different percentages of missing data, the error is different. So I think it's just a coincidence. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
If I may ask another question. All these results is for the predictive case or the reproductive case? I mean, you observe the data and you try to predict the observed data again, or is it like try to predict the new?
Okay, so here. What we do is actually we have the original data from the experiments, and what we do is we select regions, which we remove those regions, right? And then we using this, once the removed regions, we estimate these regions that we have removed using our algorithm, and then compare to that of the original data. So here what we have the original data, but it's kind of, I mean, the model doesn't know that there was,
yeah,
the data has been removed.
Okay. I mean, so you could extend this algorithm to the parametric case,
like
by parameterizing this gappy SPOD model, so that it can not only recover the missing data but also predict the new solution.
Yes.
It has not been seen.
Yes, before. Yes, that's what we have been trying with some collaborators, working on that. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so to just summarize this part of my talk, so we have a new algorithm that leverages both spatial and temporal coherence of SPOD for reconstructing these missing data, especially for statistically stationary flows, and it outperforms both Kriging and gappy POD. And one thing which I have not shown here, but we have also observed, is that it works well in the presence of high noise. So here, even on removing, once we remove this region, so even in the presence of noise, we can estimate this without the presence of noise. This might require some fine tuning, but this can also be done for the presence of a noisy data. So now moving on to the second part of my talk. So in this, I will focus on characterizing the intermittency of these coherent structures and show how they will correspond to the different extreme events. So intermittency is a characteristic of turbulent flows. So here I'm showing two different examples. One is the bursting of these streaks. So streaks are these long meandering structures where they meander and finally they burst into form these vortices. Another example of intermittency is in the case of superdirective radiation. As you can see here, this is a superdirective radiation being emitted in a jet. So if I choose a point in the far field and look at its pressure time series signal, so this is what we get, where you can clearly see these high regions of high activity. So the commonly used techniques for characterizing intermittency are wavelet transform and short-term Fourier transform. So if you perform wavelet transform on this time series signal, in addition to the time instances where we have this high activity, we also get the information of the frequency, as can be shown by here y-axis. So these methods, both wavelet transform and short-term Fourier transform, only characterize intermittency locally, that is at each spatial location or instant. So as opposed to this, what we do is we propose a method that takes into account the entire spatially coherent flow structures and tries to characterize the intermittency of this. For this, what we do is we will extend SPOD for identifying the frequency time analysis. So in the previous part of my talk, where I have used inverse SPOD, in this case, we get the expansion coefficient for each block. But we actually require the expansion coefficients for each snapshot. That is, we require time continuous expansion coefficients. So in order to do this, if we would actually require performing SPOD with a very high overlap, but this in many cases is computationally intractable. So to circumvent this, what we do is we take a convolution approach where we first project the data onto these SPOD modes and then move them one snapshot at a time and then perform the convolution over each of this and to obtain the expansion coefficients A. So these are time continuous now. So once we get this expansion coefficient, we can then reconstruct back the data using this expression. So these expansion coefficients contain both the frequency as well as temporal information of the corresponding SPOD modes. So this will give us the information of intermittency corresponding to these coherent structures. So here, to identify the intermittency, what we use is we use the frequency time diagrams that we plot by taking the absolute value of these expansion coefficient. And here I'm showing the contribution of the leading 10 modes and that of the leading mode over here. And these regions where we have high intensity regions, or which is represented in bright yellows, represents the time instances where there is a high similarity between the SPOD mode of that corresponding to that frequency and that of the snapshot. And later I will show that these actually also correspond to the high energy events. So these for example represents these high instances where there's a high similarity between SPOD mode and that of the snapshot. So these frequency time analysis give us the temporal information, whereas the SPOD spectrum gives us the statistical information of these SPOD modes. So if we were to take the expected value of the expansion coefficient for each frequency, and we will see that they show a beautiful collapse to that of the eigenvalue spectrum, and they are perfect in this case. So this only shows us two different sides of the same coin. So this represents the temporal information, whereas this only shows us the statistical information. So now to look at the presence of high energy events, what we do is, for example, we look at in this region where from 1200 to 1600 and look at the instantaneous energy of the entire data and a rank on approximation of the data. And in both cases, what we observe is that the energy peaks at the same time instances that corresponds to this high energy event. So this corresponds to this bright yellow spot. So this indicates that, especially this region indicates that whenever there's a high similarity between the mode and that of the snapshot, that actually corresponds to a high energy event of this. And now, finally, here I would like to show the deconstruction of the flow field and physically in a physical sense. So for here, I will choose a different frequency, the frequency of 0.5. This I've chosen specifically because it corresponds to the Kelvin-Helmholtz wave packet. And here, what I'm showing is the absolute value of the expansion coefficient, and this is the magnitude for this. And we note that this is the time instance that has the maximum value, global maximum. So I will choose this and then plot the original field and compare that with the mode weighted by its expansion coefficient of here. So on doing so, we can clearly see that at this time instant, the original flow field orients itself in such a way that it resembles the Kelvin-Helmholtz wave packet in that of the near field. And whereas obviously the higher the larger wavelength structures are not obtained because they are present in a much lower frequency, and even once if we scale them with the expansion coefficient as well, we can obtain a good match over here. So this is a qualitative comparison. For a quantitative comparison, here what I'm doing is I'm taking the real part of pressure along the lip line, that is R equal to 0.5, and plot that for the that of the SPOD mode, for that of the original snapshot and that of the mode weighted by this expansion coefficient. shown on the right y-axis. So here we observe a perfect phase alignment for this. So overall, what this shows is there are time, the turbulent flow is intermittent, at some time instances, it orients itself into the form of a wave packet. And whenever this happens, it actually corresponds to the high energy burst over here. And finally, to conclude this part of my talk, we have first shown how this can be used for identifying the intermittency of the different coherent structures and how it can detect the frequency time analysis. So here, additionally, there are some other extensions which I've shown, could not go over it due to the constraint of time. This includes denoising, and another work which was recently done by my colleague on reduced order modeling, where they use this expansion coefficient and a Koopman-based operator for modeling flows. Now I will move on to the last part of my talk, where I will focus on the triadic interactions. So that is, we extend SPOD to third order statistics, that is to optimize the third order statistics and characterize these triadic interactions. So the quadratic nonlinearity arises from the convective term in the Navier-Stokes equations that is given by this expression. So if we take the Fourier transform of the velocity, we get different frequencies. And if we plug this back into this expression, then there's a cross interaction between different frequencies. So F1 interacts with F2 to give rise to F1 plus F2. And various other different combinations. So this is what we we call it as a triad, where two frequencies are interacting to give rise to the third one. And this is the corresponding modal representation of this. So triads till now have mostly been investigated at a single spatial location, but not between different coherent structures. So what we do is we take a more global perspective of this and use the bispectral mode decomposition to identify these different triadic interactions. Yeah, so in signal processing techniques, what people have done is the pointwise bispectrum. So that is given by this expression, which is nothing but a expectation of three different frequencies. And what our method, that is the bispectral mode decomposition, does is it essentially computes a spatial integral of these entire three different frequencies over all different variables. And on doing so, we get this BMD, or the mode bispectrum, that is shown here. So to interpret this, so we have on the x-axis frequency 1 and on the y-axis frequency 2. And along diagonals of slope minus 1, the sum of these two frequencies are constant. So if we look at the top isolated triangle, this represents the sum interactions between F1 and F2. And the bottom right triangle represents the difference interactions between F1 and minus F2. And a special case in the case of turbulent flows is along the lower diagonal, which where F2 is equal to minus F1 and corresponds to the mean flow deformation case. And these modes bispectrum has high intensity regions, which represents the highest triadic interactions with the strongest intensity. So in BMD, what we do is we essentially compute this bispectral density matrix shown here, and note that this circle is nothing but a Hadamard product here. And because this matrix B is non-Hermitian, what we have to do is we have to solve a numerical radius problem as opposed to the eigenvalue problem to obtain A1. And once we obtain the expansion coefficients, we can then compute the mode bispectrum that is given by this, and that of the BMD modes that corresponds to the shows the coherent structures corresponding to the different triadic interactions. And to show the efficacy of our method here, what we do is we show it on a forced turbulent, on forced turbulent jets. And so we perform forced turbulent jets as it is a first step towards performing closed loop control of jet noise. And so we have first simulated an unforced turbulent jet and then forced it at different frequencies and wave numbers. And we have also validated our simulations against the companion experiments that have been performed at University of Poitiers by Peter Jordan's group. And we observe a good match both for the unforced as well as for the forced cases. So first, before I dive into the bispectral analysis, I will show an overall energetic analysis. So for the unforced case, so here different M represents the different azimuthal wave numbers. So for the unforced case, we observe a broadband like spectrum, whereas for the forced case, we observe peaks at different frequencies. In particular, in the M equal to zero case, we observe peaks only for the axis symmetry component, whereas for the higher wave number forcing, we observe peaks at different wave numbers. In particular, if we first look at the M plus minus one forcing, more clearly we observe that we observe peaks at harmonic wave numbers at harmonic as peaks at even harmonic frequencies in even azimuthal wave numbers. That is, M0 has 2, 4, 6, and the odd azimuthal wave numbers have peaks at odd harmonic frequencies. And in the coming slides, I will actually show that this is actually a resultant of the different triadic interactions. They occur in such a way that they only give rise to odd harmonic frequencies in odd azimuthal wave numbers, and so on. So now, if we first perform bispectral mode decomposition for the unforced and forced jet, what we get are these two spectra, where for the unforced case, we get a similar to what we had observed previously, observed a broadband-like nature with most of the energy at low frequencies, and the energy decays significantly as we go to higher frequencies. Whereas for the forced jet, we observe a grid-like pattern where with local maxima at the intersection of these grid lines. And here is a closed zooming view for this, where we observe that the most dominant triadic interactions are due to the self-interaction of the forcing frequency with itself and due to the destructive interference between the second harmonic and that of the fundamental frequency. So this triad is actually representative of a feedback or a backscatter effect, where there is energy being going from a higher frequency to a lower frequency. So this gives us a framework to identify the different triadic interactions in forced or tonal jets. So now if we have to look at the plus minus one or plus minus six four cases, we have to shift to a three-dimensional representation for this. So for this, I have different planes where corresponding to different azimuthal wave numbers. So we first harmonically force these two modes, which are represented by these coherent structures. So on forcing them, what for the basic interaction is they interact with each other to give rise to M0 and the second harmonic of 2STF over here. Another pathway also exists where these both can self-interact to give rise to M2 and M-2 and 2STF. And in this case, what we observe is both these mode and this mode are actually symmetric or complex symmetric. So what we observe is, so that's why I will only represent them in the positive plane positive plane just for the sake of redundancy. And so this represents a forward cascade in a wave number as well as in frequency space. Furthermore, once we obtain these coherent structures by the result of the first order interactions, then higher order interactions will occur when this can interact with this to give rise to higher terms, as can be shown here. In all these cases, what we observe is 1 and -1 will interact to give 2 and 0 and then higher terms. And the overall trend observed here is as interactions results in higher frequencies, they have much smaller wavelengths, and these wavelengths and these coherent structures are concentrated in the region near to the nozzle lip. And for higher wave numbers, these exhibit a larger swirl. And to finally explain what we had previously observed, so we can clearly see that these triadic interactions are the result why we only observed peaks in even harmonics in the even azimuthal wave numbers and peaks at odd harmonics in the odd azimuthal wave numbers. So this, using the bispectral mode decomposition and the different kind of forcing, we can clearly show the presence of triadic interactions that are important in turbulent flows. And finally, to summarize this part of my talk, so here we have a new framework for identifying the triadic interactions due to external forcing or even any tonal frequency. And our method also identifies the coherent structures associated with these triadic interactions, and it can quantify the nonlinear interactions across different frequencies and azimuthal wave numbers. And finally, to before conclude, I would like to acknowledge my advisors, PhD advisor Oliver Schmidt, postdoctoral advisor Tim Colinius, and other collaborators. And I would also like to thank NSF, ONR, and AFSR for their support in my research. And finally, to conclude, I've shown three different extensions of SPOD and its various other approaches, where in the first case I have looked at the reconstruction of missing data, and in second case the intermittency of coherent structures, and in third case a nonlinear technique for identifying triadic interactions. With this, I would like to thank you for your attention, and happy to take questions.
Thank you so much for the wonderful talk, Akhil. Okay, let's have a Q&A session. If you have questions, please unmute yourself and ask questions. So let me start with my, I guess it's a comment. Mm-hmm. So recently we have came up with a gappy autoencoder.
Mm-hmm.
So it's okay. Extension of the gappy POD, but you mm-hmm. have extended that to the gappy SPOD.
Mm-hmm.
But we have further extended to the gappy autoencoder.
Okay.
The motivation of that is a lot of times, when you have the dynamics which is not easily compressible using the linear subspace mm-hmm. representation, both POD and SPOD uses the linear the compression, right? So for that, the nonlinear manifold representation, such as neural net through the autoencoder, shown pretty promising compression.
Mm-hmm.
So we use that, and then in order to apply that to the recovering the missing data,
mm-hmm.
Develop the gappy autoencoder. So I, would like to welcome you to. Check that out. And,
Yeah, that sounds really interesting. I mean, the one thing which in many cases gappy SPOD can be problematic is because in terms of data sets, convergence of data sets, for example, we require more data for it to work better, right? And if it's a very short time series, probably the results might not be as accurate, because SPOD is entirely based on the statistically stationary assumption and requires a large amount of large time series lengths for its convergence. So I think probably your autoencoder would not suffer from such a limitation, and it would be great to look at that.
Yeah, that would be awesome. Well, of course, it doesn't solve every problem, because mm-hmm. the training of the autoencoder is a lot more expensive than POD or SPOD.
Yeah, I agree.
All right. Well, I can see that the application of this gappy SPOD is not just the turbulence; it can be applied to many different applications. Have you reached out? Maybe in your university, mm-hmm. probably you know, those application guys or physicists who probably get a lot of benefit from your gappy.
Yeah, work.
So, I mean, if you haven't done that, please do so. I mean,
yeah, sure. I would like to. I mean, I have like, I mean, most of my concentration has been like on Turbulent flows and like simulating flows. So, I mean, I'm more focused on this. But yeah, I mean, yeah, sure. I think it would be nice to reach out to other ones and like look at, like see how it's applicable for other cases as well.
Yeah, I'm also would like to open that up. Collaboration opportunity to the folks at Lawrence Livermore National Lab and,
okay. Yeah,
and as well as the people who just joined, you know, in this DDPS seminar as
yes.
well.
Yes, yeah, sure.
From everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right. Any questions from audience?
Yes, I have just one more question on the end of the second section. I think in the last slide, you had shown LAS data with the noise and then the gap SVOD sort of regenerating without the noise.
Mm-hmm.
So is the noise in the LAS data, is that intentionally forced data or is it something created because of...
No, we intentionally included the noise, yes. In this case we have to probably fine tune the gappy SPOD algorithm a bit. The only fine tuning is like, for example, let me just go back. What we see is, for example, this is what you get in a normal case where there's no noise, but whereas in the presence of noise you would get like a floor like this, for example. It's you get these kind of peaks and then you get like a white noise spectrum over some region. So then what you would have to do is you have to probably cut off the you can use it a proper threshold to cut this off at those frequencies and to then reconstruct this to avoid any noise in reconstruction. So that's why when we get this, we get the place without noise. Yeah.
Great. Right, thanks.
Okay. Any other question? Well, if not, let's thank our speaker, Akio, for the wonderful talk. And thank you so much for coming here and then gave a wonderful talk, and it was very awesome. It was very nice.
Thanks for inviting me and giving me the chance to reach out to many people. Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, so that concludes today's DDPS seminar. Let me stop the recording.
Yeah, if anyone has any questions and would like